Hi there, welcome to another Stellaris Death Star 99 Ground Combat and Army Rework. Well, they say war never changes, but the war is going to change massively in this update. We have defense armies and fortresses. Defense armies cannot be built anymore. What? They will be provided by training centers like that are called fortresses. With assault army management, armies are going to be in space from now on. Combat with retreating and collateral damage, all gonna change. You cannot attack with 20,000 troops at once anymore. You have a fixed combat width per planet. And as you can see here, there's also some orbital bombardment changes and attachments are going down. What will replace them? We'll go into that very soon. Now let's go into the details. So, defense armies and fortresses. Yeah, defense armies, a largely meaningless exercise in Stellaris. Very often, yes. I mean, you could slow down invasion forces a bit, at least AI invasion forces, and that was about it, right? That was also because of that they were so cheap. So, yeah. So they'll do away with that thing. So an exercise in futility, not anymore. They have decided to rework defense armies into something that's actually useful, but requires a significant investment of resources to muster more than a token defense. Instead of being directly buildable by the Empire, defense armies are created from certain buildings. The capital building will produce defense armies depending on its level, as will some other planetary uniques like the Military Academy. If you want a planet to be well defended, however, you'll need to construct fortress buildings on its tiles. Fortresses require a pop to work them. Do not produce any other resources than a small amount of unity, but provide a significant amount of defense armies to protect the planet. So armies spawned by fortresses are also impervious to orbital bombardment and will not be able to be killed without first ruining the building itself. So they are sitting in the fortress shooting. The armies generated by a building have their species and type set by the pop working it, so a very strong battle thrall will produce several powerful defense armies if placed on a fortress, and special pops like droids will produce their own variants like robotic defense armies rather than the normal ones. And Psy people will probably produce the Psy corpse, right? Fortified worlds will also be able to fit with an FTL inhibitor. The exact way they get them is not yet determined. That prevents enemy fleets from leaving the system unless the world is captured, which allows for the creation of fortress worlds to protect strategically important systems. That is from the science. It's strange, but I mean, an FTL inhibitor. It's also strange. We had them in Master of Orion 2 too, and yeah, it just adds a lot to strategic combat, but I mean, it takes away the feeling of freedom, the feeling of emptiness in space maybe too. So it's going to be interesting, but it's going to be less different maybe. We'll see how it works out. Here, the Savanti, probably the favorite people of of Wiz. He's playing them all the time. You can see the fortress. Unrest minus 50 already produces 2 unity, so a small amount of unity. Massive fortress complex with an expanded garrison, heavily shielded and near impervious to orbital bombardment, providing 5 defense armies, additional to the capital building that also provides a number of armies. So the building icon is a placeholder. Yeah, that's what we need to say there. So, and a change to unrest. The armies and planets no longer reduce unrest directly. Well, yeah, we have the fortress to unrest to handle the unrest, right? And otherwise, we'll need to construct fortress-style buildings to take away the unrest or take other measures, such as using edicts to reduce the planetary unrest. So you cannot simply capture a planet and spam a dozen defense armies to immediately zero out the unrest. As part of this, we'll be balancing certain events and effects to ensure newly captured worlds do not instantly defect back to their former owner. And why would they not do this? I mean, if you don't leave back troops, you should be able to leave back troops there. That's my opinion. And transform them into defense troops. And that could be it. Like, that could be how you hold the world. But We'll see how it works out. I mean, it's going to be interesting. I mean, this is more a gameplay solution than a reflection of a space reality yet. So they will work that out, I'm sure. Finally, the defense, as part of these changes, defense armies have received a general buff, and there are several new technologies that unlock additional tiers of forts and various improvements to defense armies' combat ability. Oh, nice. Not only the two or so defense armies that you have at maximum tech level, meaning they will grow stronger alongside the invention of new, more powerful assault armies. Oh. Yeah, well. And the assault army management. They're reducing the micromanagement of armies. Assault armies will now always automatically embark onto their transports, ready to be used to invade another world. Yay! And they also aim to fix the minor but immersion-breaking bug where the transport fleets are giving endlessly increasing sequential names whenever they land and embark again. Yeah, I was annoyed by that always. I had kind of resignated on that. But if they fix that, it's so small, but it's feeling such a big improvement for that. You can now finally name your army like the, I don't know, the Squadron of Black Death or the White Knights or whatever, and they will be named the White Knights forever on, and that's going to be cool. And combat with retreating and collateral damage. So, new mechanics in the form of combat with. It is determined by the size of the planet and decides how many armies can be taking and receiving damage at the same time. So if 20 assault armies invade a world held by 10 defense armies with a combat width of 10, all 10 defense armies will be immediately engaged in battle. By only half the assault armies will be able to deal and receive damage, with additional assault armies joining the fray as the armies in front of them are destroyed. This means that it is no longer possible to take a well-defended world without losses by simply throwing 100 clone armies at it. If you wish to minimize losses and thus war exhaustion, you will need to invest in expensive, high-maintenance elite armies. Yeah, I think something like a mountainous planet could also reduce combat width, right? Is that how it works in EU4? It reminds me of EU4 so much. The combat width. And how is this, I mean, how is this imagined in the planet itself? It's so... How would you imagine that? I mean, a planet is so big, and you must have a massive force then if it's limited by the combat width. But as I mean, it may be so. So the interface not final. Yeah, they'll make that more shiny, hopefully. I mean, it's not that important, but making things more shiny is good. You need to give the artists something to work. Not only new portrait packs, right? We've also added the concept of collateral damage. As armies fight on the planet, civilians and civilian infrastructure is caught in the fighting. Each time an army deals damage in battle, it will inflict a random amount of collateral damage, which increases planetary damage dissimilar to orbital bombardment and can lead to the death of pops and the destruction of buildings and tiles. Oh, that makes sense. I mean, I would love to have them like damaged, so you have ruins of X there. So if you need to rebuild, you don't have to remember what was there. Some armies will deal more collateral damage than others. For example, Xenomorph armies are highly destructive and cost efficient. It will wreak immense havoc on the planet, potentially leaving it in ruins in the process of capturing it for your empire. Oh, that makes sense. I think that's really nice. That is, I love that. While working on combat mechanics, we also took the time to change the way morale damage works, making it something that is suffered by both sides instead of just the loser, making the effects of it more gradual so that armies suffer a drop in combat efficiency once they are below 50% morale, and then another sharper drop when they are broken, 0% morale. This should make a certain army, such as Psy armies, highly effective against low morale opponents like slave armies, but less effective against an unfeeding army of droids. Yeah, that makes absolutely sense. Finally, we've also tweaked the damage dealing algorithm so that damage is less evenly spread among combatants, making it so that even an outnumbered force can destroy regiments and inflict war exhaustion on the enemy. Closer to reality, I love that. Yeah, let randomness rule. The randomness comes in clusters, and these clusters should be represented here. As you can see here, these guys are taking damage, this is taking damage, but they are also like unevenly distributed damage. That's much more realistic. That's also feeling more alive. And some changes to retreats. That's also a really good change. A significant chance that each retreating regiment is destroyed while attempting to return to space, making a retreat a risky endeavor and eliminating the tactic of simply sending the army in and again in wave attacks. Eliminating that tactic. So something you do in order to preserve at least some of your army in a poorly chosen engagement. There could also be surprise armies, right? Surprise. Like that militia that popped up, or not. Then we have got orbital bombardment changes. I like it too, but it's not as revolutionary as the army changes. Finally, get in the interest of reducing micromanagement needed during war, change the way orbital bombardment works. Fortifications have been entirely cut from planets. There's no need to bombard lightly defended worlds before going in with the ground troops. Instead, added a requirement that planets cannot be invaded if there's a hostile starbase in the system, so the transports cannot snipe worlds that are protected by defensive installations present in the same system. Orbital bombardment, instead of being something you have to manage and wait for in every single planetary engagement, is now something you do to soften up a particularly well-defended target or simply to wreak havoc on the enemy's planet and drive up their war exhaustion. So, war exhaustion. That is coming too, yes. There's war exhaustion now. A secret on the 11th of January. War exhaustion. Maybe that's got to do something with it. I don't know. As a planet is bombarded, the fleet will deal planetary damage, ruining buildings and killing pops. Bombarding fleets will also do damage to armies present on the planet, unless those armies are protected by a fortress. In that case, they'll just damage the fortress. Over a long enough time can decimate a defending force, though doing so will likely cause heavy damage to the planet and may delay the attack long enough that the owner of the planet has time to build up their forces or inflict enough war exhaustion to force a peace. The rate at which the planet is damaged can also be slowed with the construction of buildings such as its planetary defense shield, further dragging out the process. I like that. So we can have proper defenses now that work, and we can have proper assaults that are heroic instead of just making checkboxes, as it feels now. You have a big enough army, that's win. That's win. Without losses, of course. As part of these changes, consolidate that the bombardment stances into the following selective. It's normal damage to armies' buildings and light damage to pops, cannot kill the last 10 pops. Indiscriminate deals heavy damage to armies, buildings and pops, cannot kill the last 5 pops. And Armageddon deals massive damage to armies, buildings and pops, can turn planets into depopulated tomb worlds with enough bombardment only available to certain empires such as purifiers. Oh god. But I like that. It's very flavorable. Flavor. That's good flavor here. Maybe they'd need new names for that. Selective it isn't a grand enough world. We're doing selective bombardment. Maybe you want to go for like something precise fire or something like that. An indiscriminate, yeah, maybe too. But they need new words for that. Yeah, that's something minor, but I like to have the atmosphere there. And selective is just like, it's good to show what it is, but it can be formulated more warlike. Attachments, finally, the topic of attachments, they are eliminated from the game. And a variety of ways yeah, discussed a variety of ways to improve the way you assign them, but really I've only rarely used attachments because of the hassle that was involved. And because you didn't need them with a ground combat at the moment. But ultimately decided we already have so many types of armies, not nearly enough combat mechanics to justify a significant investment of UI time that could go towards something like the fleet manager instead. Yeah, better they make these big changes very, very well made than going through the attachments that I guess few people use really effectively. They are easy to use if you use them. They are it's clear what you take. So it's not really a big decision. Yeah. With these changes also to to go for the attachments, that could be done later. They could be reintroduced. And if that system, that new system is running, the attachments could be reintroduced, and that would be interesting and good, but not now. Technologies that previously unlocked attachments will be changed to give other effects, such as direct buffs to certain army types. So, there's the hiatus. Also for me, there's the hiatus. That's probably the last video I'm recording this year. But be informed that I've actually stacked up massive videos that are being rendered right now, and there will be the schedule over the year change, and you'll have your usual, if you're one of the regular subscribers, you will have your usual schedule continue. That is my Christmas present to you. It was, yeah, because around Christmas, and I wish everybody a nice Christmas or whatever you celebrate. Around Christmas, I've got everything full of relatives here, also blocking access to my main recording computer room, and I've only, like, I'm wandering around with my old laptop. That's all I can do, so I can tweet or answer to comments, but really, it's out of the question to record stuff. So, thank you for watching. Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, and have a good time until next time, and happy gaming to you.